life, our pursuit of wisdom and guidance, it's a community event. It's something that that we do together, and we move away from the presence of fools and those that are not in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And whether it's that employer, that first employer, or it's that teacher in college that is maybe not the right type of influence, we're to seek those right types of influences. Or God willing, if it's a husband or co-workers or classmates or even churches, right? We are to follow and find people to work with. This is a community event that we are to undertake in life. It's the pursuit of wisdom, and it's something that we're to do together. And as the scriptures say, the wisdom of the prudent is to discern God's way. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior, we are thankful, Lord, for our baccalaureates, Lord. We're thankful for Courtney and the journey she's made it thus far through high school, Lord, and with all the wonderful adornments, Lord. We just ask for a special praise and blessing upon her as she continues on in her education and in her life, Lord, in the next few years. We just ask that you would keep her safe and keep your hand upon her, Lord, as she continues to build up in this discernment of wisdom in the Lord. Father, and for Marissa, wow, what a life event here, Lord. It's not that she hasn't been part of the real world, Lord, but she is certainly in it full on from here forward, Lord. And we just pray that you would continue to keep her path bright, Lord. Keep your hand upon her and keep her way straight, Lord. Surround both of these people, Lord, with bright people that are godly and oriented to seek your wisdom and your will, Lord, and a community of believers and family members, Lord, that support you, Lord, and will use godly wisdom and discernment to support Courtney and Marissa the rest of their lives. We thank you, Lord, for this. In Jesus' name, amen. Alrighty, we're going to dive into the message here. And I think about the last couple of weeks here, and there would be one thing that probably would identify us with the last couple of weeks, and that's rain. We have certainly had absolutely enough rain, I think, for most of us. Even, in fact, Heidi called this morning, and she said, "Well, I'm not sure if I could make it in because the rain has knocked out my power, and my basement has got water starting to rise in it," or whatever it is, and God, praise God, here she is. So it's been a rough couple of weeks, I think, for a lot of folks. And as we think about this as a natural calamity or something that happens, a calamity is something which is a disaster, or at least it's a perceived tragedy. And as I mentioned in the opening, when the Jews prayed about rain, they actually prayed for blessings because, wow, at least the crops had enough water. Well, of course, there's balances with that water. You can flood out crops, and it could be an absolutely horrible tragedy if the crops are all destroyed by too much rain. And even in this last week here, our house, we had tornadoes that were just coming by it. And I was talking to Dave Weiss not too long beforehand and making sure that we're all in the basement getting ready for this, and the power is knocked out in our house for a while. In fact, these kind of calamities happen all the time. The most extreme tornado ever on record was in the tri-state area right around here, and it was in Missouri, Illinois, and Indiana. It covered all three states, and it actually ran for 3.5 hours as it covered 219 miles. And this happened in March 18th, 1925, and actually killed 695 people. Imagine that, just a huge swath of trees and towns getting blown apart and people laying in the destruction of this tornado. These kind of calamities happen all the time. In fact, other calamities that we think about are like a volcanic eruption. And there, Mount Tambora in Indonesia in 1815 killed 92,000. Calamities happen all the time. Floods in China in 1931 killed 3.7 million people. Just calamity. The Black Death from the 1300s to about 1700 in Asia, Europe, and Africa killed over 100 million people. So when we look at the tornadoes of our lives and a lot of the difficulty, the rains and things like that, you know, sometimes ours are a little bit smaller, but still it's calamity. And, you know, oftentimes natural calamity is even a little more obscure. So maybe it's not something quite as wild as a tornado, but you know, certainly we have wildfires. We see them all the time out west. And in 1871, here in Peshtigo, Wisconsin, well, there was a big wildfire, and it killed about 2,500 people. Sometimes, being in Wisconsin, we think of calamities being even minor in the wintertime, and we have blizzards. And in Iran, there was a blizzard in 1972 that killed 4,000 people. And I've even learned of really obscure calamities. There's something called a limnic eruption. I had no idea what this was, but a limnic eruption occurs when the gas which is sitting on the bottom of a lake, typically CO2, begins to suddenly erupt, and the whole lake overturns and the CO2 comes up. And when it comes up, the CO2 is less dense than air, but it's lighter than water, but denser than air, so it actually lays right over the surface of the water. And that CO2, what happens when you breathe in CO2? You die, right? And it actually comes out from the lake, the whole lake overturns, and then it floats out across. And this actually happened twice. Lake Maroon and Lake Nyos, these are over by France. One was in 1984 and the other one 1986. The first one killed 37 and the other one killed 1,800 people. I mean, that's kind of a sort of an obscure natural calamity. Only happened twice, and you know, kind of scary. You could wake up dead someday from something like a lake overturning. You know, sometimes calamities are man-made. We think of sociological calamities like terrorism and war, right? 9/11 was a man-made calamity. A man decided to go fly into these buildings. We have things that are related to the technology, like the space shuttle in 1986, the Space Shuttle Challenger explosion. In 1977, there was a miscommunication in the Canary Islands between a couple of jets that were on the runway, and it killed over 500 people as two jets collided on the runway. And even sometimes they're not resulting in death, but in 1977, there was an extended power loss in New York City, and there's all sorts of civil unrest going on all over the place. You know, the thing about calamities is that they're personal. Whether it's natural, as we would classify it, or it's obscure, right? If you were one of these people during this Limerick eruption, or it's man-made, whether it's 9/11, or it's the power loss in a city, or it's the power loss in our home, calamities are personal. And when I think back to the story of Jonah, we have this storm, which was sort of natural, that he was on, remember, he's on the boat, and then he ended up in a whale. So, you know, God brings the whale, and it's kind of self-induced. But in all cases, the calamity for Jonah is personal. He's probably asking himself, why is this occurring? More specifically, why is this occurring to me? And oftentimes that's what we do. When we look at the challenges in our lives, when we look at the calamities that are there, we ask, why is this happening to me? Why? What's God trying to do? What's he trying to accomplish through those calamities? And today I think you can know not only what God is doing through those calamities, but more importantly, how are we to respond through calamities? And how can it be a God-honoring situation when we, like Jonah, acknowledge the sovereignty of God, submit to the sovereignty of God, and bring the message of God out of a calamity through our own lives and to the communities that are around us? Just like Jonah brought a message of God after God kind of got his attention and turned him around, he actually took that message to the city of Nineveh. Maybe it's been a rough few weeks for you in the storms here, and certainly in Jonah, he had a rough time in the storm on the ship. God will bring a whale by your life to bring you out of that storm and to help you move through the calamities of life. But to do so, we need to acknowledge the sovereignty of God. We need to submit to it. And God will bless us through that. And his desire is that we'll bring the message of God to the people within our communities. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior, Lord, we know that there's all sorts of difficulties in life and calamities, Lord. Some are appear to be natural, Lord, and some are man-made. And it doesn't matter because in the end of the day, Lord, the calamities affect our lives and it's a very personal thing. What is important, Lord, is how we respond to any of the situations in life, and that We look at those and we understand that you have a purpose, Lord. And in those purposes, we can find fulfillment. And in that fulfillment, Lord, we are called to come closer to you. And as we're closer to you, Lord, as we become more loyal, more faithful to you, Lord, that message would resonate within our lives. And we would take that message to those that are closest to our lives and those within our communities, Lord. We pray that we would be faithful to the task that you've given us, Lord, and that we would respond appropriately to the calamities that are sitting in and amongst our lives, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. As we move through point one in your outline, we're going to talk about how we can connect to Christ during a time of calamity. But to do so, we need to acknowledge his sovereignty. So if you remember the context of what's going on here in the book of Jonah, Jonah did not go to Nineveh as he was expected to. Instead, he went to a boat, and he got in Joppa, and then he headed off to Tarshish, which is probably in Spain. Right, and as Jonah is sailing around the ocean here, right, God hurls this huge storm against the ship. And if you recall, the crew members on the ship, they start praying. And they're praying. They want some kind of relief from this calamity that's at hand. And when the prayers of the crew members become fruitless, there's nothing else to do. What do? You remember? They cast lots. And then what happens? And they cast lots, and the lot comes to Jonah. And Jonah says, hey, pick me up and throw me into the sea. Now, I don't know about you, but when a calamity hits me, if you're in the ship, the last thing you want to do is go overboard. Because while you thought it was bad in the ship, clearly being out of the ship is even worse, right? So we may be in a bad situation, but getting out of the ship is even worse. What would compel us, what would compel Jonah to get out of the ship? Think of it. He clearly knew he was running from God, right? He knew he was in the wrong. And for whatever reason, maybe it was shame or remorse, or at this point, he's just fessing up to God that he had been running from him all the way to the point where he would actually say to these pagan ship members of his, that it's him. It's time to get out of the ship. I think about that in my own life, and I wonder, are there times and points in calamity where everything is going awry, and it starts to come out, and you say, you know what? It's just all over. I've given up. It's not worth it anymore. Well, I think God had tracked down Jonah, had exposed his folly. His guilt was so obvious that Jonah surrenders to the situation. You see, you can't run from God. Calamity is horrible. And when it comes about, you can't run from God. There's nothing you can do about it. At some point, you need to turn around and face God and face up to the music. I think of this story that I heard. There's a church member that came up to his pastor and he said, you know, a tornado just came and trenched out my house, ripped down the whole house. And the pastor said to him, well, maybe God's trying to get your attention. And he said, maybe. Did you know the tornado came and trenched out your house also, pastor? And the pastor said, well, you know, the ways of God is mysterious. Who's to know what he's up to? You know, it's a matter of perspective. When the calamities come in, we need to take a serious look at our lives and see, what is God trying to get a hold of in our lives? Look with me at Jonah chapters 2, verses 1 and 2. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God, from the belly of the fish, saying, I called out to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me, and out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. This word Sheol, it reminds us of this concept of death. At least in the Jewish concept, it was this concept of death or a statement of being in the underworld. Well, it's tied to this calamity because there's two points that are going on here. First, in verse 1, Jonah is praying, but where is he praying from? He's praying from the belly of the fish. Well, at that point, he's actually out of the storm. Verse 2, the second prayer, which is actually the first prayer in chronological order, says, and I called out to the Lord out of my distress. The implication there is that the distress that Jonah was calling out was when he was within the storm. You see, we cry out in desperation. When we are in the deepest depths, as it says in verse 2, I called out in my distress. It's that spiritual drowning that we're seeing when we're all wrapped up in calamity and God is trying to get a hold of our attention. And just like Jonah has two prayers, the first one is probably at that point when you are drowning. When's the last time that you experienced a spiritual drowning? Or it could even be a physical drowning. Maybe unemployment for a while. It could be a physical issue with the house, the sump pumps overflow. It could be, a friend does you the wrong way. Whatever it happens to be, there's a point where you just feel at the deepest, lowest point. You actually have a spiritual drowning. And the indication here is we need to call out. We can't run from God. We need to call out. And God will, as he says here, he will answer me in verse 2. I called out to the Lord out of my distress, and God answered me. What's interesting here is there's two bellies. It actually refers to the belly of the fish in verse 1, and in verse 2, the belly of Sheol. And this concept of a belly, it's kind of like a womb in this way, right? You're kind of in the womb of the calamity, and you need to be delivered out of that. And God brings a fish by, and he delivers him from one womb to the other, to the womb of salvation. So, when you read this, you want to keep in mind that Jonah is referring to two points of distress. One was a pastime when he was in distress, and the second time was a point of probably lesser distress or a point of which God was saving him. So the first point of distress was when Jonah was drowning, and the second point was when he was in the fish. Well, it's interesting because we think about being in the fish, and I doubt Jonah called and said, God, I'm drowning. Send a fish, right? Hard for us to understand exactly how God is going to answer our cries of distress. But what's important is a few things about the answer from God's call when we call out in distress. First, he does answer us. That's what it says here. And I called out, and he answered me. And out of the belly of Sheol, out of my distress, God called me. The second point to think of is Jonah was clearly guilty, right? That's why he jumped overboard, right? Why he said, throw me overboard. Jonah was clearly guilty. Even when we're in distress and when we are absolutely guilty, Jonah is saved. And in that same way, despite our guilt, despite God's judgment upon the situation, God will save us. And what looks like an impossible circumstance, the example of the ship being ripped apart, just getting utterly destroyed, God will save us in the right time. So God saves us when we cry out. He saves us despite our guilt and the judgment that's upon us, and he also saves us at the right time under almost impossible circumstances. So no matter where you are, whatever issues are in your life, God will save you, will provide an answer for you, will provide a big fish for you. When's the last time you called out in desperation? Nothing makes us despair in our distress like that time when God calls us out of our distress. Nothing makes us despair or reflect upon the sin, the guilt, the negativity in our lives, except for the time when we are in distress or despair or when we are in calamity, and God gets our attention and says, now is the time. Now is the time. I wonder, what would actually compel us to call out? Would we actually call out? So often, I think the book of Jonah is criticized for being perhaps fake. People would say it's impossible to live in the to live in the belly of a fish for 3 days. Well, I'm not sure if that's so impossible. Jonah actually drowned. If you look here in verse 3, right? For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded around me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. Right? That's a tall order that Jonah is being saved from drowning. So, I don't think it's too impossible that God would actually make this account very realistic and true. In fact, Jonah is referenced in 2 Kings 14:25. It's also referenced in Matthew, and he's also referenced in the book of Luke. So at least from a biblical perspective, we have good evidence that Jonah is actually a legitimate story. It's not just some nice parable. It's an actual, legitimate, real historical account. And, you know, furthermore, you read down, and as you look at this, the floods surround me, your waves, your billows passed over me. And as you look down below, it talks about in verse 5 that the deep water surrounded me, the weeds wrapped around my head, and the roots of the mountains. Where do you see mountains in the ocean? At a very deep level. When was Jonah written? Thousands of years BC. The first diving bell wasn't even put together until the 1500s. Somehow, Jonah had knowledge of how the sea was constructed before we even would have knowledge of it for thousands of years later. So no doubt the historical accuracy of the book is true. Does it matter, though? Will that make you cry out any more to God in desperation? Tony Evans said it this way. He said, you know, the big fish that swallows Jonah is no big deal. In 1891, off the Falkland Islands, there were two fishing boats that were hunting whale. And they came across a huge sperm whale. One group in the boat shot the whale. And the other boat came around behind it, and then the tail of the whale hit the boat. Boom, hit it. Well, one guy was killed immediately, and the other guy was lost. 2 days later, another boat came by, found the same whale, and actually shot the whale and caught it. They took the whale up to the land, and when they got the whale up to the land, they cut it open. And what did they find inside the whale? There was an unconscious man, but he was still alive. And after a little bit of care, maybe some hot soup or something, he came back and was revived. So the story of Jonah isn't quite that far-fetched. And you know what? What's not far-fetched is living in the belly of a whale. What is far more exciting and fascinating is that a big, dumb whale would come at the command of God to save a man. You get it? What's amazing isn't the calamity that you're in and that God will save you through that calamity. What's amazing is the mechanisms that God is in control of. All the situations in your life that you think are out of control, if God can take some big whale and dive it to the depths of the ocean to scoop Jonah off the bottom and save him and spit him out on dry land, he can build a fish for you as well. That's what's amazing. That through God's sovereign purposes, when we acknowledge God's sovereign purposes, God uses calamity and God is sovereign over every calamity and all of its purposes, and he does it to get our attention and to provide a mechanism of salvation. During calamity, God answers our deepest cries of desperation with Christ, and he will provide a fish. It may not be the fish that you're thinking of. It may not be the way out of the situation that you want, but that's where we put our trust and our faith and our hope in Jesus Christ. We need to connect to Christ during calamity by submitting to God's sovereignty. So it's one thing to recognize that God is sovereign. It's a whole other thing to submit to it. And if you think about where Jonah was at, look at this with me in chapter 2, verse 3. For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the sea, and the flood surrounded me, and all your waves and your billows passed over me. The billows passed over Jonah. He was sinking to the bottom of the ocean. Down, 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 down. I'd say Jonah was in deep trouble. There was no getting Jonah out of that storm, out of that situation. He was going down, down, down. And what does God do? He provides a big fish. So what's the last time God sent you a big fish? What did it look like? Maybe it was the job you didn't get. Maybe it was the school that you got into, but not the right type of program. Perhaps it was a fix for a car rather than a new car because the new car you didn't know it was a lemon, right? There's a million things. It could be the husband or wife that you've been dreaming of that you never got, and maybe God brought somebody else in. It could be a million different circumstances that God is using and is absolute control of that you're not even aware of. And when we step back and we look at those fish that God provides, it gives us an opportunity to focus and say, only because of God. It allows us to focus on his holiness. Look with me here in verse 4. Then I said, I am driven away from your sight, yet I shall look upon your holy temple. See, it was too magnificent for Jonah to realize that it's not because of his swimming ability, because he could float better than a bobber. Jonah was in deep trouble. He was in the bottom of the ocean. And when he understood that position, when he understood probably for those brief moments of consciousness that he was awake in the fish, he had a perspective that said, I focus on Christ's holiness. I believe in the fish that God has provided, whether I like it or not. We can be fairly sure that Jonah did not pray, hey, God, put me in the belly of a fish. But it was like God provided just enough consciousness for Jonah to understand the mechanism of salvation. And I think that's what happens in our lives. So often we are just barely aware of what's going on. Life is moving by so fast. We don't understand where God is going necessarily. We don't see all the final points, but God will grant us enough consciousness, enough points of awareness, even in a smelly fish or whatever mechanism God is using to deliver you from calamity, for you to recognize that God is holy and he's in control. I notice that Jonah doesn't complain about his surroundings. Compared to drowning, the fish wasn't that bad. Otherwise, ugh, who wants to be in the belly of a fish? As we look at verse 5, you'll see that there's an understanding that Jonah was raised up in this belief, that it caused a whole new way of thinking. The waters closed in over me to take my life, and the deep surrounded me, and the weeds were wrapped around my head. You know, the fish, the whole perspective on the fish when the weeds are all wrapped around his head and Jonah's laying on the bottom of the ocean, the fish doesn't seem so bad. And not only that, no doubt when the fish came by, it was probably a moment of, I don't even know if Jonah knew it, but a moment of new life, refreshing. And probably the moments of consciousness that Jonah was in the belly of the whale, he was aware that he finally had new life. So not only was he saved, not only did God bring the fish, but he realized that God had rescued him, literally snatched Jonah out from drowning, or if he was drowned, revived him and brought him into the fish. And that's what we need. We need to accept God's plan. When we're raised to new life, when God provides the fish to us, when we understand what God is doing, we need to be accepting of God's plan. When we are raised to new life, we need to put our plans back on the shelf and pick God's plan up. There is no amount of swimming that Jonah could have done to get himself out of that situation. He had to accept the plan that God had offered. In this case, it was the fish. And he offers kind of a prayer or a petition about this in verse 6. And at the roots of the mountains, I went down to the land whose bars closed up on me forever. Yet you brought me up my life from the pit, O Lord my God. This whole thing, chapter 2, verses 1 through 6, is a prayer. In fact, all of chapter 2 is a prayer. And in this case, what you see is Jonah's actually looking forward now to a new life, coming out of calamity. When God brings that fish by your life, it causes us to pray persistently, continually. We get to conclude with Jonah that when we are delivered into the belly of a fish, we have a great affirmation for what God is doing in our lives. You know, but so often we get into the belly of the fish and then we start to question it or we start to think otherwise. Look in verse 8. Those who pay regard to vain idols forsake their hope of steadfast love. No doubt at this time when Jonah's in the belly of the fish, he's got no other hope than the fish that God has provided. But he reflects back on those that don't have that same relationship with God. They don't recognize the fish. What they have, as it says in verse 8, is they pay attention to vain idols, other things which distract them from being salvaged out of calamity, vain idols. What are those vain idols in our lives? Those things that keep us from surrendering to God's plan. Maybe it's the quest for money or power, or we're just not content with the things that God has provided in our lives. Do we have vain idols, those things that keep us from surrendering to God's plan? You know, true sports fans have an amazing ability to remember details, statistics, and little technical rules about the sports that they follow. And as Christians, if I thought of our lives and our relationship with Christ, as a sport, I would wonder, would we pay attention to the details, the statistics? You know, sports fans know all sorts of stuff that nobody else really cares about because they have an intimate relationship with the sport. In fact, sports fans, they're fanatical. They persevere all the way to the end. What would happen if we had a sports fan mentality? When the calamities of life came on, we had a sports fan mentality and we got our arms around God and we set all the excuses to the side and it ignited a passionate relationship with Jesus Christ. Think of this. These are excuses. If you were a sports fan, you might give these excuses to say, I no longer want to be part of that sport. One, you know, the people when I go to the stadium, they just don't feel friendly. They're just not perfect. And because they're not perfect, I just don't want to go to the stadium anymore. Or maybe when I go to the stadium, they actually ask me to pay. Well, I'm using the facility, but geez, what's with these people? The seats are uncomfortable. Maybe that's a reason to no longer go to a sports game. The coach doesn't come to see me. I don't have a relationship with any of the people on the staff. That doesn't work. The referee made a decision I just couldn't agree with. They threw the wrong flag and I don't agree with it. Game over, I'm not going to the sport anymore. I was sitting with some hypocrites. They were actually fans of the opposite team. I won't participate in the sport anymore. The game went into overtime, and I got home late. It's just unacceptable to participate in the sport anymore. The games are scheduled when I have other things to do. I don't want to participate in the sport anymore because they always have these games and they're like, you know, they're always at the wrong times when I have other things I should be doing. Maybe here's another excuse. My parents took me to too many games when I was growing up and I've had enough sports for my life. Perhaps I read too much Sports Illustrated and I know more about the game than the players do. I don't want to take my children to the sport because they have their own sports that they'd like to make their minds up about. I would never want to ask my neighbor to go to a sporting event because I don't know if they would like it. I mean, they got their own things going on. They just may never like to go to a sporting event. You see, excuses have been defined in the skin of reason, and then they're stuffed with a lie, right? So if you take excuses and you stuff it with a lie, you no longer participate in the sport. And I think about that during calamity. So often, it holds us back from crying out to God. So often, it holds us back from being focused on what God wants. So often, it holds us from submitting to the sovereign authority of Jesus Christ in our lives, because we have a whole list of excuses and reasons and why we can't participate in the game. And all God is asking for, he's asking for us to surrender. He's the coach. He's got the game. He sets the rules. He's just asking for us to participate in it. During calamity, God will refocus our attention to Jesus Christ, and he does so by asking us to submit to his sovereign authority. Let's finish up here as we look into Jonah 2:9. You'll see that salvation does belong to the Lord. It's only because of him. And God will help us through this calamity. In 2:9, but I with the voice of thanksgiving will sacrifice to you what I have vowed I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Or deliverance belongs to the Lord, depending on your translation. Salvation or deliverance belongs to the Lord. I think that as we understand who sent the fish, it's important for the right perspective to be brought onto the situation here. It's the deliverance belongs to the Lord. Deliverance for Jonah, the fish came because the Lord commanded him, not because Jonah particularly wanted a fish, not because Jonah could call the fish, not because Jonah had anything to do to help to bring the fish along. It did. The fish came because God commanded it. And that same salvation that's available, whether it's from a point of calamity or ultimate salvation in our lives, is because God is directing all things. Flip over with me, if you will, to Matthew chapter 12. just going to look at a quick passage here. I want to show you how this comes together in our lives. Matthew chapter 12. We're going to look at verses 38 and 40. This sign of Jonah, this book, is not just a whale's tale. It's not something that's just, hey, that was an interesting story. It's got a huge theological implication for us, and it's something that we are to take up in our own minds and understanding. Verse 38 and 40. And then some of the scribes and Pharisees answered him, that's Christ, saying, "Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you." But he answered them, "An evil and adulterous generation seeks a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah." Is that fascinating? This whale's tail, this fish's tail, those things that are foolish from Scripture God is using. "For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a great fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth, and the men of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it. For they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, something greater than Jonah is here." So you ask, you know, how can somebody survive in the belly of a fish for 3 days? And maybe he can't. You know, there's some examples here, but in general, that probably doesn't happen. And that's not what's important. What's important is that God sovereignly ordained this sign as a precursor, as a post, something that's pointed something greater than the sign itself, which is Jesus Christ. Jesus knew this was no ordinary event. It was a miraculous sign that God graciously and powerfully put forward for all men to take hold of to understand. This doesn't need a scientific explanation any more than the miraculous signs of Jesus, whether it was healing the paralytic, whether it was healing the blind person, healing the woman with the issue. It's all the same result. People cry out in their deepest need, and God miraculously sends a fish into their lives. It's that sign that God asks us to look at in our own life. These signs like Jonah, the calamities in our lives, they are signs that point us to Jesus Christ. God does this to gain our attention. If you are drowning, if you are facing calamity, even if it's the sump pump has failed in your house, the lights have gone off, you didn't get the job, the guy doesn't want to marry you, whatever the thing is, whatever the calamity is that's in your life, God does this to get our attention. And you know, God doesn't answer these things all at once. Just like with Jonah, first he was on the boat going the wrong way, then God gets a hold of his attention. There's a storm. Jonah goes overboard, and then he drowns, and then he's in the fish, and then the fish spits him up on the shore. In that same way, God works in stages in our life. It doesn't happen all at once. He won't answer us and make us comfortable all at once. God will let us know the circumstances and deliver you from the impossibilities of calamity in life, just like Jonah. God answers our guilty distress to help us become more aware of what he's doing in the world and aware of what he's doing in our life, and he's doing it so that we would become merciful people. Think about that. Jonah didn't want to go to Nineveh. We maybe don't want to go talk to our neighbors about Jesus Christ. Maybe it's that addiction in our lives that we can't get over. You know, I just want to listen to that talk show host because they seem to have the right answer. Or it's that friend in my life that's always got the right answers, but when, truth be told, you look at it, it's not godly advice. God is asking us. He's using these things to get a hold of our attention. He's using the guilt and our response to the calamity to get a hold of our attention. And he's doing it so like Jonah, that Jonah would go to Nineveh, so that we would ultimately become merciful in our lives and we would take the message of Jesus Christ forward out of our lives. We need to personally get a hold of and secure the promises of Jesus Christ in our life, just like Jonah got turned around and was saved through a fish. Because the ultimate perspective isn't just our salvation, it's the salvation of those that we come in contact with. That's exactly what it says here at the end of this passage in Matthew, right? In verse 41, "The men of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, something greater than Jonah is here." The calamities in our life are not only to get a hold of our attention, they are to accomplish God's eternal purposes through us. How awesome is that? God uses calamities in our life to get a hold of our attention so that we would participate in his plan. Let's look at our very last verse here in Jonah, Jonah 2:10. What you'll see is that there is dry land. So maybe you've been in calamity. Your life has been all turned around. Your weeds are all wrapped. Your head's all wrapped up in weeds. You are drowned, right? You can't get by just another minute. And God brings this great big fish on by. The fish is nice, but it's not the final point. Verse 10. And the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah up out onto the dry land. How great is vomit, in this case, anyways. The fish spit Jonah up onto the land. While the fish was nice, it's just a smelly old fish. And there's lots of things that God brings in our life that will save us from that specific moment, from that issue, from that calamity in our lives. But the reason God brings us the fish isn't to keep us in the fish. He brings us the fish to spit us up on dry land. Our personal response to calamity helps us extend Christ to our community. Our personal response to calamity helps us extend Christ to our community. When we are on dry land, it's our time to go to Nineveh. We're not just spit up on dry land and that's it. We're there now to fulfill a mission, to take the message of God forward. We summarize it this way. Jonah disobeyed God. God put Jonah underneath real destruction. Jonah cries out in distress, and God answers him and gives him a new lease on life. There's a fish, and the fish is a sign. And that's the same sign that's Jesus Christ that we offer, that we take that message to people. But it's not just a sign that sits in a book. It's dry land. That dry land is where we're to be at first. We need to be on dry land in our lives, saved first, and then take that message to Nineveh. So it is with the Ninevites. They disobeyed God. God put them underneath the threat of destruction. And you know what they did? They got a prophet from God. That's what you're here for. God has provided you to the city of West Allis, Greenfield, Milwaukee, New Berlin, wherever you live, so that you could be a prophet for God. God showed mercy on Jonah so that Jonah would show mercy on the Ninevites. Excuse me. The book of Jonah, the message is clear. It's about the salvation that God offers. It's not just confined to the Hebrews, right, like Jonah. It's extended to everybody, like the Ninevites. And God wants us to take that message forward. This fills us with thanksgiving and mercy. The implication is clear. God wants you to take the message forward. Don't let the calamity in your life keep you from taking the message out. Don't ignore the fish that God is sending your way. God will have mercy on you despite the guilt and the judgment that is owed upon you. God will save you from all situations. He will rescue you out of the deepest seas, your deepest distress, if you will only call out. And when you call out, God will provide that fish, and that fish in Jesus Christ is a sign. It's a sign of salvation, but the ultimate goal isn't the sign. It's the something that points greater than the sign. It's Jesus Christ. We find that dry land in Jesus Christ, and we are to take that message to the Ninevites and those that God has put in our lives. Jonah acknowledged God's sovereignty and submitted to it. Jonah brings the message of the sovereignty of God and salvation to the Ninevites, and in the same way we should do it. We need to personalize and understand that. Scott, we need to take the message of Jonah, the sign of Jesus Christ. Emily, the message of Jesus Christ. Carol, the message of Jesus Christ. Scott, the message of Jesus Christ. Heidi, the message of Jesus Christ. We need to take these messages out of our lives. We need to get out of the calamity of the life that we see. We need to find those fish that God has provided in our lives and use it as a sign that points us to the ultimate salvation that we can only find in Jesus Christ, that all of our communities and everybody we need to come in contact need to have and to hold dearly. We need to acknowledge God's sovereignty and submit to it. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord and Savior, we are thankful, Lord, that when we are guilty and we sit condemned underneath judgment, Lord, that you will provide situations and calamity, Lord, to get a hold of our attention. Father, we're thankful that not only do you rescue us out of that calamity, Lord, that you send fish, Lord. Interesting ways to save us, Lord, out of impossible circumstances. Lord, you bring these to us. You bring these to us to offer us salvation, Lord. But that fish is just the first step, Lord. It ultimately points us to dry land. Lord, it's your salvation that we look forward to, Lord, eternal hope with you. And it's that message, just like Jonah took the message to the Ninevites, Lord, that you're asking for us to take forward. Father, we ask that you would have our hands, you would have your hand in our life, Lord, that you would rescue us out of our deepest distress, Lord. Provide that fish and allow us to continue our ministry as we take the message of God from the Ninevites to West Allis to Greenfield to Milwaukee to New Berlin to Muskego, wherever we happen to live, Lord. We love you and we thank you, Lord, and we ask that you continue to bless this church in Jesus' name. Amen.